Welcome to NSTA Web Seminars, where you can find live interactive learning at your desktop. Today's seminar is called Supporting the Implementation of NGSS Through Research, with a focus on engineering. Our presenters today are Tamara Moore and Shanai Perzer. My name is Christina Crawley, and I will be moderating today's program. Jeff Lehman is online with us to provide technical support. Now I'd like to immediately turn the mic over to Al Byers. Al Byers is the Associate Executive Director at NSTA, specifically for services. And so with that, I'm going to pass it over to Al.
Thanks, Christina, and I'm delighted to be here this evening. I've been at NSTA 13 years, and the services division is one of three, and the web seminars fall underneath of that. And the reason that I would so wanted to do the introductions is this really is an inaugural presentation. It's a series of web seminars. If you look in the middle of the screen, there's actually three of that are planned with NARST, the National Association for Research and Science Teaching, and we're delighted for this collaboration. The names at the bottom of the screen, the Executive Director, William Kyle at the University of Missouri, as well as the current NARST President, Valerie Ackerson, and then the past President, Lynn Bryan from Purdue University, they were instrumental in trying to forge that contract and pick these topics. So we would encourage you all to look at the other topics that are there. After tonight's Perspectives on Engineering, there's another one on the Perspectives on Curriculum, and then in February in the new year, a Perspectives on Equity. There's two other names I really wanted to call out as well. Anytime you percolate an idea like this, there's usually someone behind the scenes and a moving force that helps bring it to fruition. So I want to do a quick call out for Kate Scammelberry. She's a professor in the Department of Chemistry and Director of Secondary Ed at the University of Delaware. And she was the past NSTA chair for the National Committee on Research and Science Education. And she put in a lot of hours working very closely with an NSTA NARS liaison. And that prior one was Deborah Hannison, and she's a professor and director of elementary ed at the University of Missouri. So without them, the people that you see on the screen, this couldn't have come to fruition. So I really appreciate their efforts to pull this together. And then finally, it's my distinct pleasure to welcome Tamara Moore as well as Shanai Perzer. Both are engineering education professors at Purdue University. And I know, having attended many web seminars over the years, what goes into pulling one of these things off to make it successful and interactive and engaging. And so let me, both of you, on behalf of NSTA, thank you for what I know is going to be an outstanding program. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and turn it back over to Christina and our presenters this evening. Thanks a bunch, guys. I look forward to participating.
Okay, great. So I think from there, we can directly switch over to Tamara and Shanai. And you guys can take it from here.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome, and we're glad you're joining us. My name is Tamara Moore, and with me is, I'm going to rehearsing her own name,
Shanai Perzer.
That's mostly so you can hear the difference in our voices, although our pictures will be on each slide as we go through them. So we're going to have a lot of fun tonight, and we're looking forward to the questions that you have, and hopefully we'll help you get more comfortable with implementing engineering in your science classrooms.
More than a year ago, when the Next Generation Science Standards was first published, the leadership of NARST, at that time Sharon Lynch and Lynn Bryan, approached us to lead this effort, focusing on the implementation of NGSS with a specific focus on engineering. So my colleague Tamara Moore and also Dale Baker from Arizona State and Lima Berlin from the University of Wisconsin-Madison wrote a position paper. And this presentation is based on this work, and the position paper is located at the link shown here. As we think about engineering in science education, there are three elements that are critical to highlight. One is using engineering as a pedagogical approach to teaching science content. In the science education literature, this is often called design-based science. Another way to think about engineering is an important content area in and of itself. And finally, the third point that is perhaps more helpful to those who might be less familiar with engineering is the opportunities engineering education provides in promoting 21st century skills.
Sorry, we have a little bit of lag when we're hitting the movement of the slides, so bear with us as there'll be a pause between each one. So the Next Generation Science Standards, or NGSS, have been released, and several states have adopted them. The inclusion of engineering in the NGSS is a shift from the previous science standards, and for many state schools and teachers, this represents a new challenge in instruction. And we imagine that that's probably why many of you are here. You're wondering about how you're going to deal with engineering in your science classroom. So we want to take a quick look at the science standards just to help make you more comfortable. The level one, which is the top white box there, that's the performance level. The three colored boxes are called the foundation level, and the white box at the bottom is called coherence. And we're going to talk a little bit about those in terms of how they how engineering is represented in each one of those in the standards. So our goal tonight is to focus on the engineering aspects of the NGSS. So the performance expectations, which is the part highlighted here, are closely related to what most people consider content standards. Here's where you'll see what students are supposed to be able to do. These are also what are considered the assessable statements. It's important to note that when the performance expectations are not engineering specific, if there's an asterisk by it, what they are expecting is that you will actually consider using engineering in that particular standard. The three colored boxes are the foundations boxes. The blue box is where engineering practices are. These describe the work of engineers with the expectation that students will engage in engineering design, including defining problems, developing models that are physical, symbolic, computational, etc., designing investigations, constructing design solutions, and arguing for one's ideas. The orange box is the disciplinary core ideas, which emphasize the aspects of engineering knowledge, such as optimization, problem scoping, and idea generation. These are things that students would focus on in terms of engineering here. And the green box is the cross-cutting concepts, which will allow for the integration across disciplines that are inherent in engineering. These concepts focus on science, society, and technology at all grades and systems thinking at secondary levels. The final white box at the bottom represents coherence. Each set of performance expectations, sorry, that didn't move on. I'm trying again. The white box at the bottom represents coherence. Each set of performance expectation lists connections to the other ideas within the disciplines of science and engineering and with Common Core State Standards in mathematics and English language arts.
So now let's put these ideas into practice. How would these practices look like in the classroom? Christina will help us go through the molding process now.
Okay, so we're going to go ahead and use the poll button that we tested out in our introduction. So if you look below your name, you've got four buttons there, and on the right-hand side you see an A. You have, once you click on that, you'll still have A, B, C, D, and E as your options. So go ahead and give us what answer you might think it is. If it's A, observing, C, seeing students, sorry, B, seeing students, C, observing, D, or E. Okay, so we've got a few people trying already. Go ahead and have a look at that poll and give us your answer, either A, B, C, D, or E. That's below your name. It's the fourth button there. If you're having trouble and it's really not working for you, you're welcome to type your answer in the chat box, but preferably try to use the tool there so we can tally your answer in the final poll. So we'll give you another few seconds to work on that.
And I know a few of you, you would like to choose more than one, but just choose which one you feel that seems the best or the one that you feel more strongly about. It doesn't mean that there's a right or wrong answer, but go ahead and choose one of those. So I'll give you maybe 3 more seconds, and then I'm going to go ahead and publish the poll onto the whiteboard. Okay, so here it is. I'll make that a little bit bigger for you. And then I'll pass it back over to our presenters.
Excellent. Thank you, Christina. All right, so it looks like we have an...
Sorry, we're trying to coordinate our movements here.
We have a number of B's, seeing students conducting experiments. Often when in our research what we see happening most is we see also C happening, which is where students are building models and prototypes. The main message that I would like to convey here is that in an effective classroom we would see all of these happening, and that the proportion would be equitable. However, there are some key aspects that are important to note as we are teaching engineering in the classroom. One is that it is critical that we promote STEM integration by explicitly spelling out science and mathematics concepts students are learning, and scaffolding students' ability to transfer science learning to their design solution. In addition, often engineering is associated with building and construction activities. So again, when we are in the classroom, it is often what we tend to see that students doing. However, these prototypes should not be the end goal, but rather be used to start discussion, argumentation, design evaluation, and further data collection. And we will later talk more about it, how to engage students in design argumentation in the classroom. And the third point is that engineering, as you may imagine, is often presented as a gendered profession. On top of this, this course is also often gendered and culture laden. Hence, it is important that we monitor as we're teaching engineering and engage students in discourse that is both collaborative and equitable. So let's spell out some misconceptions as we pointed to a couple of them. That the first one is that not all design is engineering. Although design is the hallmark of engineering, not all design is engineering. Meaningful engineering design rests on science and mathematics. Engineering is for smart kids. Of course, it's flattering for those who are in engineering to think that is the case, but it is not. It is, in fact, unfortunate that this common belief prevents many talented youth entering into engineering. You can't do engineering without high-tech equipment, or if students build it, it is engineering. Again, even in the workplace, low-cost, low-fidelity prototypes are often used at early stages of design. And not all design, in fact, involve a built product. A process can be an outcome of a design. A system could be. Think about a transportation system, for example. Think about a process that reduces wait time at a doctor's office. These are examples of solutions that are not product-based, but a process-based. And finally, research is pretty consistent on the issue that students do not learn science and math just simply doing design. The content and applications should be made explicit with the support of the teacher. So as you listen to our talk here, of course there might be other misconceptions, myths you may think about. So if you have them, please put them in the chat box.
So we are going to have another little interactive piece here. I want you to take a look at these two concept maps. And we'd like you to vote for which one of these most closely represents engineering. So take a minute to look at them, look and see how they're organized. And once you have a sense of which one you feel like you should vote for, then Christina's going to help us to make sure that we are doing this correctly. Over
okay.
to you, Christina.
First of all, huge thanks to those of you who did put a few of your little myths in the chat window there. We had some good ones from Wendy and Judith, and then up to Elizabeth, Lindsay, and John, I think, as well. So thanks for those. I'll let Tamara and Shania look at those. But if you do want to, we're not going to use the pull button for this one. So let's go ahead and turn our clip art on. So go back to that little mountain with the sun there. And if you can put a little stamp underneath either of those images directly on the whiteboard, then we'll do the voting that way. So for those of you who don't know where the clip art is, it's that little little board that's just to the right-hand side of the participants window. There's 9 different buttons. It's the bottom button where it's a little image of a mountain and a sun. Just click on whatever stamp you choose, and you can do exactly what the others are doing here on the screen and put a stamp directly on the whiteboard there. So with that, I'm going to turn it back over to our presenters. So I think there's a little bit of trouble with the audio. I'm going to let Tamara and Shanai take it from here. If you want to have a look at what everyone's been putting on the board, go ahead and take it from here.
Okay. That's it might just be us who are having problems here in Christina, because not everybody in the moderator panel is having trouble, but we're having to lean totally close up to the computer in order to hear it. But we can hear Al really well when he talks, so sorry about that, everybody. We're not always sure when it's time for us to come back in. all right, so clearly people like the one on the right. There's a few people who choose the one on the left, but and then we had that one smiley face going back and forth. That was fun. These are both work from in-service teachers who were working with me probably about 7 years ago, and we were introducing engineering. And the one on the left was their, they did a pre and post concept map. The one on the left was their pre-concept map. So as you can see there, the concepts were good concepts, but they were really focused on the kind of engineer that exists, electrical, computer, aeronautical, et cetera, the different types of engineers. Where the second one, after they had spent some time learning about engineering, really more focused on a process of engineering and how engineers think. Now, they didn't get rid of the idea that engineers are broken up into subdisciplines. You can see that around the center. But they really, the big idea in the concept map was much more related to the process an engineer goes through in order to solve it. So with that in mind, we're going to talk a little bit about a definition of engineering for K-12. And when the slide moves over, I want you to notice that there is a URL. Christina's going to put that URL for you in the chat window, because apparently you can't click directly on our slides like you could if it was a PowerPoint. But that tiny URL there is a Dropbox site that Shanai and I have put together. We put several things in there that you might be interested in having. And, of course, throughout this presentation, if you are interested in having something else or you want some resources, you can let us know whether or not there's something that we can add for you into that space. And if we have it and have access to it and are able to share it, we will do so. So this is a, like I said, it's a definition of K-12 engineering. It was developed actually to be able to look at state standards and look to see what kind of engineering existed there, but we found it has a lot of other uses, and in fact, helping someone understand that engineering isn't just design and that there's so much more to it has been one of the good outcomes of this. So I want you to take a look with me, and I'm going to give you a one-sentence version of each one of these different, what we call indicators of engineering is what we're saying here. So the complete process of design. Design processes are at the center of engineering practice. Solving engineering problems is an iterative process involving preparing, planning, and evaluating solutions. And students should understand design by participating in each of the sub-indicators there, the problem and background, plan and implement, and test and evaluate. So the problem and background is the identification or formulation of engineering problems and research and learning activities necessary to gain background knowledge. And actually, before I go on, I'm going to tell you that there's an entire paragraph about each one of these in that tiny URL drop box. So the plan and implement piece is like brainstorming and developing solutions, judging the relative importance of constraints, and the creation of a prototype model or other product. And testing and evaluating is generating testable hypotheses and designing experiments to gather data that should be used to evaluate the prototype or solution and to use this feedback in a redesign situation. So, of course, if we want to use this in our science classrooms or math classrooms for that matter, we need there to be good, solid mathematics and science knowledge happening in there. So this is the practice, or so the applied science engineering mathematics knowledge indicator is the practice of, that engineering requires the applications of science and math, and engineering knowledge and engineering education at the K-12 level should emphasize this interdisciplinary workings between these two. So the engineering thinking indicator represents that students should be independent and reflective thinkers capable of seeking out new knowledge and learning from failure when problems arise. And this is one of my favorite reasons for putting in putting engineering in the classroom. Now, I was a math teacher. I wasn't a science teacher. But, you know, I, as a former math teacher, what I really struggled with was that generally I taught math like there was one right answer. And I think many science teachers feel that pain too, like science, there's a right answer to all the science things that we do. And engineering is really a nice way to get away from that because the whole idea is that you're doing a product for a client and through that failure is going to be a piece of that. And you're looking for what's working and what's not working and how can we improve this so that we meet the needs of our client, which is very nice. So the conceptions of engineers and engineering is really focusing then on that they need to understand, the students need to understand what an engineer does. The engineering tools is that students who study engineering need to become familiar and proficient in the processes, techniques, skills, and tools that engineers use in their work. These tools in your science class are probably the same tools that you want them to learn for science. It's just that in this case, we're going to be applying them in an engineering setting. The issues, solutions, and impacts indicator is about solving complex and multidisciplinary problems. That if students are going to do this, they need to be able to understand the impact of their solution on current issues and the vice versa version of that. Like what kind of impact does the solution have on, or what do issues have an impact on their own solution? From an ethics perspective, engineers consider ethics all of the time. This is an incredibly important part of engineering, and it's a really hard part to bring up in a K-12 classroom. So I highly recommend you think about this one carefully as you can. Here, students should consider ethical situations that are inherent to the practice of engineering. This is about, a lot of times, about whether or not you should do things. Genetic engineering, which is a very popular, you know, 7th and 9th grade topic, there's a lot of questions on what should and shouldn't be done within genetic engineering. So bringing up those ideas, letting kids argue it out, should we design this, should we not, those sorts of things, that's what we mean by ethics in engineering. Teamwork is your typical cooperative learning kinds of things. And so in K-12 engineering education, it's important to develop students' ability to participate and contribute as a team member. And communication related to engineering, this is really talking about the kinds of communication an engineer would do. Communicate to their client through writing, through a presentation, through a schematic or a diagram, or through an argumentation justification kind of space where they're going to talk about why the science is, or how, why the engineering works because of the science that they're learning. On the left, you see a version of a design process. This is a version that my team and I created in order to be able to talk about what we mean by design throughout this definition of engineering in this K-12 engineering. However, what we want to make sure that we say, and we're going to go through this very carefully in a few minutes, is that this is not the only representation of design that's out there. This is Tamara Moore's version of engineering design. But there's many out there, and they each have different kinds of merits to them, both problems and good versions. Because remember, it's a model. It's not a perfect, there's no such thing as a perfect model, and mine's not perfect either. But you'll see this again later, and this particular model has been downloaded into that Dropbox that for the tiny URL below. All right, so this brings time for a couple of questions, and so we're going to turn this over to Christina to moderate the questions for us. Hopefully, we're going to be able to hear her.
Okay, so if you have some questions, go ahead and type those in the chat box, and then I'll do my best to repeat them for Tamara and Shanai. And I'll repost those as well. So maybe if we'll take this first question from Al. When, if time permits, I'd be interested in what one or two ethic examples might be for K-12 that you found viable or not volatile. So Tamara and Shanai, do you want to tackle that one?
Sure thing. So certainly ethics is a big deal, but I think one of the places that is a recent, at least kind of recent example that most of us as adults will remember is the when the bridge from Minnesota fell down, the one for the I-35W bridge. You guys remember that one? The issue there was really a very small piece of the bridge that was definitely undersized. And we don't really know why it was undersized, but one thing that happens often in engineering is that you're working on trade-offs. You're looking at something like cost versus safety versus, you know, what the client needs. And there's probably three or four more things that you're probably considering all at the same time. And these are competing variables with one another. And so when you can bring up issues around those things, like when you have an activity, and we've done a bridge activity where we use that context of the bridge falling down, then you can bring in these ethical ideas. Of course, genetic engineering is rife with it, like we talked about before, but the bridge one's a little bit different, and you can look at that in another way. And generally, it's a little harder to find good ethical spaces in K-12, and that, to be honest, and I don't think every single engineering design activity or engineering thing that you do in your classroom needs ethics to be a part of it. But when it comes up and it can tie into the solutions that you're working on, talk about, you know, the interactions between technology and society and science and engineering, those are really beautiful places where we can talk about ethics and how engineers have to consider ethics all the time. Do you have anything to add?
So another example I could say is in terms of sustainability. So the projects that my team is working on, focusing on building green buildings. And often the ethics in that context relates to, as Tamara said, cost versus sustainable design. So where students find that the best design in terms of the most cost-efficient design is not necessarily the one that is more sustainable. So I think that is where students will be in that dilemma or ethical decision, where do they go with the one that meets the cost constraint, or do they think about the broader environmental context and come up with a solution that may cost more, but again, those are, I see them as, there are technical decisions, again, with the data, but there are ethical decisions integrated within that kind of problem.
And of course, our little cartoon represents an ethical dilemma that those two fish are having, right? Part of it's not a load-bearing wall, but of course, he's going to kill his friend there when he gets through there. So we thought that was kind of a funny little piece to maybe make you chuckle, even though we can't see you and see if you are laughing.
Okay, so maybe we'll go to the next question. This one's coming from Lindsay Wells. I'm going to repost it there in the chat box for you. Why isn't communication included as part of the design process?
It can be. We were pulling it out to give it emphasis in this case. So we wanted to make sure that it was a highlighted piece of what we're going to do. But you'll see in one of the design cycles later that we'll show that they've added communication right into their model.
Okay, great. And maybe we'll take one last question as well. And we'll take this one from Mohammed. And he is wondering, what is the difference between engineering design in elementary and in high school? And I can repost that as well if you need to.
We're going to hit this part pretty heavily in the next section, so maybe we'll save that. And if the question has not been answered, we'll come back to it. How's that sound?
Okay, sounds good. So with that, maybe we can move on.
Okay. Yeah, also I want to add that most of my work in engineering education in K-12 focused on middle school and high school, and Tamara's focused on elementary and middle school. So, all right. So as we talk about design, so why design? So one way to think about it is what scientific inquiry is to science, design is to engineering. But coming from a perspective of an engineer, I see inquiry, scientific inquiry, happening within the design space. Again, you will see in our presentation today that it is basically the perspective you are taking, that from an engineer's perspective, this is how we are seeing inquiry happening. So what is design process? We often, again, similar to the earlier question, hear questions about what is the best design process, which process to use. The best way to think about design is a set of strategies. A set of strategies students use to design products, processes, systems. So if you do an online search of a design process, you will see a variety of processes. So here, we share a couple of them. And some of these processes might be familiar to you. So let's first look at them. So what is the difference between these three processes? One is that stands out clearly is the number of steps. For example, the one on the left has 8 stages. The one on the right has 12. And the one that you made at the bottom part of the engineering is elementary unit has 5 stages. Again, often they all start with identifying the problem. There's an idea generation later in the process, and goes into a model or a prototype. And as you can visually see that these are cyclical, circular processes, suggesting that what I call macro level iteration, that you go through the whole process, not once, but it's an iterative process, that you go through the whole process multiple times. What is not shown in these processes is what I call micro-level processes. So again, addressing the questions asked earlier, so the one, the third one on the bottom is the model used by within the engineering, the elementary, used in the elementary curriculum, and the ones upper. The other ones that I have more steps often used in a secondary level design processes. Okay, so I mentioned iteration, and this term is could be not familiar to those who are not engaged in design, but by iteration I mean the process of repeating a process, or a test, or even going back and forth.
between various stages. So this is, let me show you another example of a design process. This one is in fact my favorite one, representation of design. As you see, it looks messy, but you see a lot of arrows. It is only three stages: inspiration, ideation, implementation. Inspiration focuses on understanding the problem, exploring the problem, understanding the context. Ideation refers to idea generation, developing ideas, testing these ideas, building prototypes. Implementation is the path to moving from idea to realization. So I would like to, however, to really focus on these arrows you are seeing, for example, this one, as again, the model looks more messier in a sense that the process is may not look clear, but what I really like is with this model is that the iteration, micro and macro level iterations, are evident, and you can see that the arrows are shown in both ways, so which is you could go back and forth. Again, I think one message hopefully you will get out of this presentation is that there is no one single method. Again, you saw the model here earlier as part of the picture. Sam and Tamar will talk more about this. And I would like to talk more about this. This is a representation of a process followed by a student. This is coming from a project where students are designing net zero energy passive solar buildings using an open access free computer-aided design software developed by the Concord Consortium. It's a pretty cool software in that it is not a computer-aided design, but also it does simulation, energy simulations, cost simulation. So the inquiry, scientific inquiry data collection happens simultaneously along with construction. So in an example like this, where we tend to see the iterations happening in this space, where students are able to build models and test them, evaluate them, and through their testing, they actually, the system generates data, so they make data-based, evidence-based decisions. Mm-hmm. So in conclusion, there are multiple ways to represent design as a process. Hopefully we did not confuse you, but the key message that we want to deliver here is that there is no one step-by-step process, but there are best practices where we will see beginning designers and informed designers behaviors that are distinctly different. These are four behaviors that I listed, they are simplified from David Christman and Robin Adams' work on informed design, where what we see, what we want our students to be designed more like informed designers, which involve doing research on the problem, testing solutions, conducting experiments. We would see students generating ideas, and large number of ideas, and don't just get fixated on an idea and don't want to change. We would want to see our students using graphical representations to weigh benefits and trade-offs. Again, often design problems involve constraints, criteria, trade-offs that when you meet one criteria, you may make your design worse in another criteria. So these are difficult decisions that require some sort of organization. And finally, I have been iterating on this, but informed designers iterate in a managed way, manage way, and engage in reflective thinking. So it might also be helpful to think about informed design in a different perspective. For example, you can think about doing research. When I said earlier, inquiry happens within design, this is what I'm referring to, that you can think about scientific inquiry happening when students gather data on, let's say, the energy efficiency of their building, cost, material cost, test different solutions, conduct experiments by changing different variables, so forth. You can also think about the 21st century skills, which relate to idea fluency, for example, with relationship to creativity. Or you can link ability to make decisions, making trade-offs, to critical thinking and problem solving. Again, these are aspects of 21st century skills. All right, so this is the time again to see where we are. Hopefully we didn't confuse you. And if I will turn it to Christina to help with this process again.
Okay, so for this one, as one person has already gotten started, we are going to be using our clip art. So go ahead and click on whatever clip art you have and mark directly on the whiteboard where on that line your comfort level is. Sorry about that, your comfort level. And so in case you're on an iPad and it's not working, feel free to just type what your feeling is in the chat box. But otherwise, we'll give you a minute or so to work on that timeline, and then we'll switch it back over in another, let's say, a half minute or so for Tamara and Shanai to have a look at that and comment on the results.
Okay, excellent. So again, I was hoping that the way we are talking about design process being not linear and not having a one single process could be difficult to think about depending on where you are in the engineering education. But right now, to clarify some of the confusion, perhaps to help those who are who are sort of closer to, I guess, some of it, or I'm sort of lost. So that we would like to take some questions. So if you could please write them in the chat box, Christina will share it with us. Christina is.
Yeah, no problem. So if you do have any questions, I'm just going to give you a few seconds to write those down. I'm also going to put a little poll here. If you don't have any questions, feel free to give us a green check, and then we'll simply move on. Okay, so we do have one question from Deborah. She's asking, could you give some examples of things that teachers might be tempted to do as they try to integrate engineering that would not be necessarily engineering? Do you want to tackle that one to start?
So I would refer to some of the statements we made earlier about misconceptions about design. One is not all design is engineering. Again, building things that, for example, often engineering design projects are designed on the understanding that students will be applying their science, prior science and math concepts. But often the projects that we put in front of them does not necessarily require that application, and or that students are not really able to make that transfer easily. So what I would suggest in an effective classroom. In an ineffective classroom, we will see students building cool things. But in an effective classroom, we will hear them talking about data. We will hear them justifying their decisions. We will hear them connecting to science and or math concepts that they either learn through that process. And often this requires this scaffolding of the teacher asking questions about, tell me about your design. Why did you go with this design? Why did you go with that kind of a roof? And how does that design influence the energy efficiency of your building, for example, in the context of the green buildings I talked earlier?
We're going to hit this question a little harder in the next section, too.
Okay, and maybe we'll just take one last question that came up a little bit earlier from Linda, and she's wondering if this comparison is also age-related or is it developmentally different?
So the informed versus beginning designer comparison, it actually happens. So we see them happening at the elementary level. We also see this happening at the college level. So there's a often students, even before learning any engineering design, they understand the concept of building, for example. What is challenging is asking questions, or that early problem scoping, researching piece. And we see that even with engineering students who start in college, when we compare them to first year versus seniors, we see that development through their education. And in elementary, similarly, those students who are maybe who have never done engineering, they tend to focus on building rather than doing research and thinking about the applications. Those have to be scaffolded. So,
there definitely are some differences at the different levels. And certainly when you talk, but I think the differences aren't really in Shanai's beginning designer versus informed designer. The differences are in the complexity of the kinds of solutions that they can come up with and the amount of, and the developmentally appropriate math and science that they're able to apply. So with that, I think, are we okay to move on, Christina?
Yeah, we can go ahead and move on.
Okay. All right, so this gives us the idea that classroom practices, in fact, that was a really good lead into where we're headed. If we really want to think about engineering in our science classrooms, we really need to be thinking about STEM integration. What does it mean to integrate our subjects together? And these six spaces around quality STEM integration, we're going to talk a little bit about each of them, and hopefully this will give you some background into how to think about what a classroom ought to look like, which I think is also another question that came up earlier. So, first of all, a motivating and engaging context is one of those contexts where students can enter into the problem in lots of different ways. And we try to avoid the context such that the kids are going to think about engineering in the very traditional ways. Like, I generally try to stay away from cars and trains and, believe it or not, robots, unless those things are really bring in ways for kids to think about how engineers have the ability to save lives, make someone's surgery go better, keep someone safe, those kinds of things. Engineers work on things all around us. Everything we do, almost everything we touch in a day, some engineer has thought about in some way or another. And so those contexts are really, really important. And in fact, I noticed that we had Christine Schnitka online with us here today, and she wrote a middle school curricula called Save the Penguins, which allows kids to design a habitat for an ice cube that's shaped like a penguin, and the idea is to keep it from melting, which brings in great heat transfer activities and good science learning in there. But the context of this is really great because the penguins are one way that kids would engage in this. And other kids are going to be interested in the fact that she's brought in ideas about climate change and that the ice caps are melting. And so there's an environmental piece to this. So different kids will be motivated and engaged by that. But the third way is that some kids will be engaged with the fact that they're going to get to design something. So you've got a lot of different ways for kids to engage into the problem. And that's one of the really nice ways of thinking about engineering design. The second piece also relates to that, is that students are going to participate in an engineering design task for a compelling purpose. There should be a client. And this involves problem-solving skills and ties to the context that we're talking about. So this is really important in terms of the compelling purpose that goes with the context that we were just talking about. And the engineers don't work for themselves. And really, that's a key difference between what a science, like a bench scientist does, and someone who's a real true research scientist. Really, they get to ask whatever questions they want about the natural world. And so while somebody else may pay them, they, in effect, work for themselves. Now, of course, that's not true for all scientists. Lots of scientists work for industry, et cetera. But, you know, the most basic nature of science, scientists would be working for themselves generally. They can get to ask the questions that they want. An engineer hardly ever gets to really work for themselves. They're always solving someone else's problem. And so that client piece is very important. We talked about this one earlier. STEM integration really does need to allow students to learn from failure. And in order to learn from failure, they have to have that opportunity to redesign. So you let them try, you let them create their prototype, having done a very good job of making sure that they've included science and math in that, science and or math into that design. But then you want them to test it in a meaningful way and have the opportunity to redesign so they get the opportunity to be successful in their designing. And if we're going to put this in our math and science classes, and in particular, I know here we're looking at science classes, it needs to include meaningful science. And we're going to talk about that, how we might be able to guarantee that a little bit more easily in a moment. Of course, we want to teach our content with student-centered pedagogies. Engineering is not one of those things where you can lecture at kids and they're going to understand it. You learn to engineer by engineering. And so using student-centered pedagogies as we're working in the classroom, things where the students have their hands and their minds on it, and they're the ones doing the justification, this is the kind of thing we're talking about. But also when you're thinking about the science that you want them to learn, make sure that that they're learning the science with student-centered pedagogies as well. And finally, this one's come up multiple times, we want to really promote our teamwork and communication skills, and those are good skills for all citizens to have. And I think that's an important point to make about the whole idea around STEM integration is that we don't necessarily want, like Shania and I, our goal is not to create a bunch of engineers. What we really want is students to have the opportunity to do whatever they want when they grow up. And engineering is, if you're prepared to be an engineer, you're prepared to be anything that you want. And that's really our goal. So we want STEM literate citizens who have the opportunity to do whatever they want in life. So when you look at it as a whole, that's really our way of looking at STEM integration. And this was actually published in a couple of different places, but I thought since this was an NSTA webinar that I would include my ScienceScope article that came with this one. So if you'd like to take a look at that one. And that greenhouse design includes a middle school 7th, 8th grade unit that goes with it. So when you download it, it includes an entire unit that you can look at. Okay, where are we? All right, so if we're going to talk about in our science class, which we really did highlight this part earlier, then we're going to talk about what this actually could look like in your classroom. And how do we make sure the science is really important and used carefully in our engineering spaces? And if we're going to do this, one way we've thought about potentially is about by using argumentation. And so our colleague Joe Krychek at University of Michigan did a presentation a few years ago called Engaging an Argument from Evidence, which was really about argumentation in science classrooms. And we listened to that and we found that it was very useful, but argumentation isn't particularly well defined in engineering yet. So let's take a look at it quickly from a science perspective and see how we can look at it also then in an engineering design activity. So in science, the production of knowledge is dependent on a process of reasoning from evidence that requires a scientist to justify a claim about the world. In response, other scientists attempt to identify the claim's weaknesses and limitations to obtain the best possible explanation. So that's basically the way the NGSS looks at argumentation. And in particular, he says the process of defending explanations by carefully ruling out other alternative explanations and building the case that data collected are sufficient and appropriate to serve as evidence for the current claim is another piece that's important in argumentation in science. And so I want you to take a minute to think about what that means. That really means that science is the nature of science is that someone puts out some idea, and then other people have the opportunity to make counter arguments against those ideas or to provide other evidence that support those ideas. And we think that this is a good way of helping think about how we can do this in an engineering setting too. So since argumentation is not really defined for engineering, we began to start to think about what could it look like. So if you see the part down at the bottom, that this blue circle, you know, argumentation is really the idea that you're gathering data about something, and then you're going to analyze and interpret that data, and then you're going to make claims that you support by evidence and provide an explanation for what you're working on. And while there's not much work in engineering, there is a definition that came from this particular slide set, but this is not a K-12 application. But they say, in engineering, arguments are an external representation of the mental reasoning behind the development of engineered technologies. And I think it's important to think about here that every engineering process results in some kind of engineered technology. Technologies do not have to be things. The processes we talked about before, those are all technologies. When you think about the most efficient way to recycle in a city, for example, that would be a technology. That plan for recycling would be a technology. So not every technology has to be some physical thing, and it certainly does not all have to be a digital thing. Okay, so with that in mind, we decided to look at our particular design cycle, and you are welcome to vote for more than one if you'd like. Where do you think argumentation fits in engineering design? So we're going to turn this over to Christina.
Okay, so for this one, we're going to go ahead and use the clip art tool again, so you have access to that. Pick whichever stamp you like and vote where you think student argumentation can fit into the engineering design. And again, as mentioned, if you want, you can vote for more than one of those. And if you can try to even make those little icons, those little stamps small, so that we can fit in as many as possible, that'd be great. You just kind of shrink it directly on the board there. All right, that looks good. Okay, so we'll give you a minute or so to work on that, and then Tamara and Cheyenne, you can go ahead and comment directly when you're ready.
Okay, as we see, we think there's a possibility for argumentation fitting all sorts of places in here, and I see people are voting multiple places and perhaps changing our minds as we go along, and that's great. And in fact, what I'm getting ready to present for you is not a finalized version. It's where we are right now. So you'll see that we've thought through this some, but there are certainly other places that it can be. And one thing to note is that oftentimes when you teach science content, science content happens during the background stage, and of course argumentation will fit when you teach the science content separate, if you teach it separate from your engineering somehow, certainly it could fit there as well. So I'm not going to cover that part. We're going to talk about it in terms of the engineering design space, not the background science knowledge that they would be bringing to it. So with that, we're going to move forward, and I'm going to help you see how we've been thinking about it right now. So Douglas Llewellyn has a book called Inquire Within. It's a teacher-friendly argumentation book, really kind of a methods type book that you can buy online. His model for scientific argumentation is this, that you have a question. With that question, you make a claim, you show your evidence, and then you use that evidence to make an explanation for why you said your claim was what it was. So this is actually like a a framework that students can actually write these things in. And he, it's a hand, like basically a handout or a worksheet that students can use. And it, we thought that this was really accessible to students at, you know, a lot of different ages. So we started with this, and we, there were several models by lots of really well-known researchers, but we ended up deciding we were going to modify this to be the way we were thinking about argumentation in engineering. So one of the places we thought that argumentation in engineering could go really well is in the plan stage. And we really thought about when a student is planning or when a team of students are planning, you could talk about argumentation in two different ways. One of those ways would be that the individual is going to be brainstorming and coming up with ideas, and they could be doing their own version of an argument with themselves. So we call that individual argumentation, where, you know, as they write down their plan, they are going, their plan includes some sort of problem, and then, actually I'm going to go ahead and move to the next slide so you can see what I'm actually talking about. This is our version of the QCEE model that we showed you before. In engineering, engineers have problems rather than questions. There's always a lot of assumptions that an engineer is making. Then here would be where they would begin to put out their first ideas about the way that they were going to solve it. Then they would provide evidence, and then they would use that evidence to have an to provide an explanation for the kind of thing that they were doing in their idea. And so if you think about this in terms of the individual, you could have the individual do this two or three times before they got together in their group, and then when the group gets together, the group could have conversations about the different ideas that they have going on here. And we think this is one of the ways that, that we can make sure and guarantee that the students are bringing science to the engineering design process, in that the science is where they're going to be able to provide some evidence, actually some math as well. Some of their data might be using some math ideas as well. And then the explanation is sort of tie those two things together. And so whether they're doing it individually to come up with their own ideas, and they're basically providing their own evidence and their own explanation to justify for themselves in an individual setting, or when they come together as a team setting, we thought that this was a way they might be thinking about it. Now, it's included that we would, of course, want to think about it in other spaces as well. And we think that the evaluate stage is also a really good place for different kinds of argumentation to happen. And so one kind of argumentation that might happen in the evaluate stage is whole class argumentation and or team argumentation. And in this case, what we mean here is that, again, the students are thinking sort of along the same lines in terms of the framework. We've got a problem. We've got assumptions. Those assumptions, or the problem and the assumptions are used to make a claim. So this is now at the point in which they are evaluating. So the evidence probably came from, you know, the test part of their design. And so now their explanation is based not only on their background science knowledge, but it's based on whatever kind of test they've done to continue to provide evidence for whether or not their solution to the problem is really going to make sense here. So from a whole class space, this might be during a presentation that you might expect that they're going to provide their solution, provide their scientific evidence for the solution, provide their data from their tests for the solution, and provide an explanation for why they think their solution is working, or for why they think their solution needs certain, actually, and or why they think their solution needs some improvement. And then, again, a team argumentation might just be that before they do their whole group, a whole class argumentation, they might actually just take their argument from a data perspective, like we've just run our tests, we have our background science knowledge, but somehow these aren't meshing. What other factors are happening? So we can imagine that the team could be having a constructive argument with one another to try and figure out what happened in their first test. Maybe you're going to give them a couple of times to iterate. But there's also one other place where we think, or one other way we think the evaluate stage might represent a place for quality argumentation to happen, and that's when we think about public understanding. And here, what we really imagine is that at some point in time, the design needs to come out of the sort of quote-unquote out of the classroom and back to the client. And so that client is probably going to represent a public view of your solution. So one thing to think about here is that oftentimes when we design as engineers, we are putting a proposal in front of our client, but we don't get to see everything else that this client is considering in terms of the solutions that they are, you know, that they've made. So you're putting a bid in to say, I can solve your problem in this way, but you don't know what you're competing against. So you really need to think through all of this ahead of time. So we have another way that we thought about our plan for communicating to the client. Again, it still starts with identifying the problem, but the claim or the prototype or your design happens here. The evidence is really where you're still going to put in all the science background that you have, any data that you collected during your tests that help provide evidence for why your prototype or your solution is a good one and why it's going to meet your client's needs. And then combining those two things into a really nice explanation for why they should choose your solution. But the thing that makes this one different is because you don't really get a back and forth conversation like you would in your whole class argument or in a team argument, you have to have thought through the counter arguments and the things that you think the client might automatically say about your design and hit those from the beginning. So this is a different way of thinking about argumentation in engineering and in comparison to science. And we're really excited about how this is working in the classroom. So we've got some teachers who are trying different versions of this, but they are, you know, they're not, we don't have it documented in a way that's ready for publication at this point. So if you decide to try some of this in your classroom, you know, I would love to hear how it's going and if that's helping you guarantee that the science is happening and that it's tied to your engineering design. Because one of the myths that I think we hit before was that tinkering is engineering. And what we mean by tinkering really is that a lot of the kinds of solutions that we ask students to design or build in our classrooms in the K-12 are really things that if you just use some of your common sense and everyday science knowledge, you can probably mess with it until it works. But an engineer doesn't have that opportunity. And really, the prototype is a very expensive thing to do. So we want, as an engineer, we want to make sure that we plan very carefully for this. And so this is a way, using argumentation as a potential way, to help the students plan meaningfully and to tie the science into what they're doing to guarantee that the science is there. All right, so that was a lot in not tons of time. So we have time for a couple of questions, and then we're going to talk about assessment.
Okay, here's a question that came up a little bit earlier, and I'm going to paste it into the chat box again. And this is from Brian. He had mentioned, and Al did kind of tackle this a little bit, maybe to get your perspective as well. Engineering has been taught as a vocational elective in many schools for many years. Are there examples of using the curriculum those teachers have built to address some of the issues we've been discussing?
You know what, honestly, I am not super familiar with anything along those lines. I think that's a good place to think about some things, but I know that a lot of the curriculum and the vocational electives are highly CAD-driven, computer-aided design, and they oftentimes really focus in on the manufacturing side of engineering. That's a very different space. I am sure that the answer to that question is yes, there are probably some really great examples of that, but I'm not familiar. Shanai said she might have something to add there.
So I guess one way I can, I work with high school teachers, and sometimes the engineering projects we have don't fit with their science content. Often they will go to the vocational, the standards related to vocational education, where they visualize the project and this is how they are able to put it part of their courses. So that's an interesting point, I think.
Okay, and maybe a second question, which is coming from Ann Leek. I'm going to put that in the chat box again as well. How do you incorporate identifying the client's needs?
That's a really good question. I've seen it done in a lot of different ways. oftentimes for me, it's usually a story up front, like in the beginning of the unit around that I'm going to use engineering design in. We'll tell a compelling story about why someone has a problem and what the problem is, and we have the students begin to think about the problem and who are the stakeholders in the problem and those kinds of things. So it's really done as a story that then includes a lot of discussion around that story. I've seen it done as a PowerPoint presentation where you really highlight whatever's being hurt or needs a little more time or a little more effort to help whatever their situation is. Sometimes it's an article where we oftentimes do what we call science-rich or math-rich articles where again, the story, it's really all about the context. So this is really kind of making sure that the client and the context go together. I think if you look at some of the curriculum that we can put in our, or that we have put in our Dropbox, you'll see some of those things. Oh, so Kathy Kennedy says, everyday science mysteries are another way to introduce engineering issues. And that's true. I have those, and they're really nice. That's a good point. Thank you, Kathy.
Okay, and I think with that, we can probably move on.
Okay. So we're going to turn it up over to Shanai for assessment.
All right. So, as we talk about bringing engineering in the classroom, one of the key points is assessment. Again, we talk about informed design earlier. Here, I would like to highlight that we want informed designers. But to do that, we need to assess things that the behaviors that will provide ways that show that students are engaged in informed design. Let me give some specific examples. For example, let's say you did three design projects throughout the span of a couple of weeks. So one easy way to look for informed design is look at the third project when you put a problem in front of the students. Are they starting to solve the problem, or are they first asking questions and asking questions to understand the context and think about different way to experiment and identify variables or so forth? Look for evidence of idea fluency that compared to the first time students engage in design, do you see them being more comfortable with idea generation? Again, make sure in student presentations, students are justifying their decisions with data and that students are able to also reflect on their process. So we had done a study with interviews with teachers, and this work is cited here, and we see that the engineering learning is complex. So when we teach engineering, there are many different aspects to focus on. One is focusing on the solution, the design outcome. One thing that people typically focus on creativity, originality of design solutions. Another one is the quality of the solution, which could be durability or efficiency, whatever the criteria is designed to meet. Another aspect that people focus on is process, design process, teaming process, or perhaps just the problem, the project management and organization. And finally, they focus on science or content knowledge, which could include technical aspects of a solution or perhaps specific science concepts applied or discovered. All right, so with this one, again, the key issue I want to highlight is that to be clear about what we are assessing, and that if we are interested in understanding student learning, looking at how durable a prototype they develop would not tell us much about student learning. And if I have talked about so far classroom assessment, but there's also assessment in terms of program evaluation, things to be careful about it, assessment bias, issues of validity with the instruments being used, and the evaluation scope, meaning being able to think beyond what teachers are learning, but their ability to implement and impact student learning. Again, I think we are getting close to the ending, but we have time for a couple questions and then we will wrap up. Christina, do you see any questions?
Yep. So there's a question here from Brian. He's asking, are there sample assessment tools or rubrics, for example?
Yes. So I think we can put couple in the Dropbox right now. We have couple articles. I have a article in Science and Children. Had one science group, but we can add additional ones, yes. And it's really, I think it's a good start to, what I would suggest is a good rubric is basically looking at informed design and building on those four ideas. So yeah, we can certainly add those into.
So, and I have a 10 question assessment that's a multiple choice assessment, which of course is not the best way to assess students. You know, performance-based formative type assessments are really much better. But in sometimes you really need a way to really quantify in a quick way whether or not they understand. And we have a valid instrument that we've created for one of our grants that I can also stick in the Dropbox. So I'll do that. It's for fourth through eighth grade. So that only helps you if you're there, although I think you could easily modify it up, probably not modify it down.
Okay, I don't see any other questions, so I think that we can move on. If there are some more, we'll pick them up later.
Great. All right, so all I wanted to remind everyone about is that we wrote this position paper that the link was included in. Actually, Christina, if you wouldn't mind, would you put that link up one more time for us in the chat window? These were the things that we saw as major challenges, but also major opportunities as we start to think about adding engineering into the classroom, into our science classrooms. And so we highly recommend that you take a look at this. We spent a lot of time and we got a lot of input from other people besides the four authors trying to make sure that we did an overall well thought through job of sending this out there. So it's only about four pages, so it's not like it's going to take a ton of time, but it may really help you solidify some of the ideas that we were talking about today. All right, and finally, just a reminder that we have our Dropbox folder. Yes, there you go. And you can add comments for the moderator if you have other ideas of things that you might want us to put in there. Christina can make sure that we get those. And finally, I guess we want to say thank you to NSTA for providing us this opportunity, and to NARST for allowing us to write this paper, for promoting it for us, and for all the work that they're doing to promote high-level science education for all students. We also want to thank our co-authors, Dale Baker and Lima Berland. They did a really wonderful job. You've got our contact information there, the link to the position paper again, and our link to resources. So at this time, turn it back over to Christina.
Yep. Okay, great. Huge thanks. So everyone, let's go ahead and have a look at our emoticon button there and find the applause so we can give a huge round of applause for Tamara and Shanai. All right, great. You can hear all those nice sounds. That was great. The both of you managed to get through a lot of content and take some time for questions. So huge thanks to that. And then, of course, I think everyone's going to really appreciate the recording afterwards as well to have a look at that. So thanks again, Tamara and Shanai. Now, in addition to thanking our sponsors and to thanking our presenters today, my apologies. We'd also like to thank our sponsors. So we'd like to thank NARST for putting this together and for this being the inaugural seminar of this kind, and we look forward to seeing more going through the school year. And then last but not least, a huge thank to NSTA and the whole team there, Al Byers, who's here with us today and helping us out with this web seminar and was a huge proponent to it and getting it started, and also to the web seminar team, including Jeff, who's here with us and has been a star in getting everyone set up and making sure that everyone can hear and follow along. So huge thanks to everybody there at NSTA. Now, you can find resources related to today's presentation by going to the web seminar collection in the NST Learning Center, and that's going to include the archive of the web seminar as well as the presentation slides. We'll go ahead and put that link in for you in just a moment. In terms of the collection, it may also include journal articles and lesson plans, interactive content modules called Science Objects and SciPacks, as well as links to other helpful websites and multimedia. So we're going to put that link in there in the chat window in just a moment. And of course, if you are here with us live today and have registered for the program, you are also going to be receiving an email within the next day or so with a link to access the archive and the entire collection. And also here, just before we wrap up, here's a look at a few seminars that are coming up. These are just a few that we just wanted to point out to you, but there are many more. So feel free to go to learningcenter.nsta.org/webseminars, and that's going to give you the entire list of web seminars all throughout November, December, and into January already. So feel free to have a look at that, and we hope to have you back. And for those of you who are new to the web seminars, that you will join us again soon. So thank you, everyone. Thanks for your participation today, for your questions, for your participation in the polls, and we look forward to seeing you again at another NSTA web seminar. Thanks, everyone.